Technology. It really makes a world of difference. New technologies have a lot of impacts, with intended and expected effects, but sometimes unintended consequences, unplanned, undesired, such as climate change. For example, in the 1930s, CFCs were introduced to increase the safety in cooling processes. Ultimately, they would produce the hole in the ozone layer. Fortunately, thanks to a rare example of successful global decision-making, this hole is decreasing now.
Welcome back to the course. You just saw a short video about the effect of CFCs on the ozone layer. In the 1990s, several governments banned the use of CFCs. Therefore, an alternative for CFC-12 had to be found. This had been the coolant of choice for household refrigerators since the 1930s. CFC-12 indeed had a number of very attractive properties. It was inflammable, non-toxic, it had very good thermodynamic properties, and it was chemically stable. However, it contributed to ozone depletion, and therefore it became unacceptable. Now, in the search process for alternatives, three values played a role. First, safety, which was specified as inflammability. Second, health, which was specified as non-toxicity. And environmental sustainability, specified in terms of ozone depletion potential and global warming potential. Other design requirements were, first of all, energy efficiency, and this meant that the new coolant had to have very good thermodynamic properties. Second, cost and availability, and third, compatibility with the other parts of the fridge. However, it was difficult to attain all these requirements at the same time. We will focus here on the conflict between the values of safety, health, and sustainability. This picture is a graphic representation of CFC based on a particular hydrocarbon. At the top, there is methane, or ethane, or another hydrocarbon. If one moves to the bottom, the hydrogen atoms are replaced by chlorine atoms if one goes to the left, and by fluorine atoms if one goes to the right. Now, properties related to safety, health, and the environment can be mapped on this figure. What we see is that if we move to the upper right corner, substances are increasingly toxic. And this means that in terms of health, we better move to the left below. Now, if we move to the top, substances are increasingly flammable. So in terms of safety, substances near the bottom are better. But if we move to the bottom, the so-called atmospheric lifetime of substances increases. And this means that both the ozone depletion potential and the global warming potential becomes larger. And therefore, they become less good in terms of sustainability. So in terms of sustainability, we should move towards the top. But we cannot move in all these three directions at the same time. So therefore, we face a value conflict. The initial way this dilemma was dealt with was by choosing a coolant that met all these three values, safety, health, and the environment, to some degree. This figure is from a publication by two engineers, and they argued that all coolants in the blank area in the figure are acceptable. And the industry indeed chose a coolant from this area. Namely, they chose HFC-134A. Now, there are several reasons for this choice. First, it was attractive for the chemical industry, because this coolant could easily be patented and it was not too inexpensive. As this graph shows, several patents have been granted to the chemical industry for it. For the fridge industry, the price of a coolant is only a small part of the price of the entire fridge. Therefore, it was important, more important that the new coolant would be available than that it would not cost so much. This means that they followed the choice of the chemical industry. And indeed, around 1900, there was a general conviction that HFC-134A was going to be the new coolant. At the time, in 1990, the editor of the International Journal of Refrigeration expressed this as follows. He said, "In my nearly 25 years of working with this industry, I have never seen this industry put so much time and effort into one problem as they have into the CFC problem. It is doubtful that any coolant has been tested more in a short period of time as 134A. But he could not know at that time that the future would be quite different. Let us watch how this could happen.
Until the early 1990s, virtually all domestic refrigerators used ozone-depleting chemicals as refrigerants. When the hole in the Earth's ozone layer was discovered over Antarctica, however, these chemicals, known as CFCs, were banned. Unfortunately, the alternatives which were then adopted, while less damaging to the ozone, turned out to be harmful in a different way. They are powerful greenhouse gases. That is why Greenpeace set out to find an alternative refrigeration technology. The future of environmentally safe refrigeration had to be with natural substances such as hydrocarbons. The idea of an environmentally friendly fridge, a green freeze, was born here at Greenpeace Germany headquarters in Hamburg in 1992. Greenpeace looked for refrigeration alternatives and found research work done at a medical institute in Dortmund, Germany by Dr. Hans Presendanz and Professor Harry Resen. They discovered a suitable mix of butane and propane which neither destroyed the ozone layer nor contributed to global warming and could be used immediately as a drop-in replacement. This is exactly what Greenpeace was looking for. The next step was to find an industrial partner willing to transform the research into commercially viable products. This partner turned out to be the East German-based company DKK, today known as Foreign. DKK was willing to take a financial risk and built the first green freeze prototype in 1992. The refrigeration industry scoffed, saying there was no market for a climate-friendly fridge. So Greenpeace went to the public and quickly amassed 70,000 pre-orders for the refrigerator. In March 1993, the first green freeze fridge rolled off the DKK assembly lines. The position of the industry changed quickly. Within its first year, major producers picked up the new technology throughout Germany and Europe. It also made its way over to China. Over the following years, persistent Greenpeace campaign work helped to spread the green freeze technology all over the world. Green Freeze was awarded the United Nations Environmental Programme's Ozone Award in 1997 in Montreal.
To understand the success of the Green Freeze, let us look at the properties of three coolants. First, CFC-12, the original coolant. Second, HFC-134A. That was the alternative that was preferred by the industry. The third one is isobutane, which was used in so-called Green Freezes. And today it is used in 300 million fridges worldwide. Now, if we compare the latter two, what we see is that isobutane contributes far less to the greenhouse effect. However, it is flammable, as you can see in the figure. And this flammability was a main reason why the fridge industry opposed it. In fact, the existing technical codes at the time banned the use of flammable coolants. Still, isobutane came to be accepted. Why did this happen? Now, to understand this, we have to look at the interpretation of the value of safety. Safety was first understood as the inflammability of coolants, but later it was understood in terms of ignition and explosion risk of a fridge. So, flammable coolants now turned out not to be so as dangerous as Stanley thought. One reason for this was that fridges contain only a very small amount of coolants. So when the standards were formulated at that time, fridges still contained much more coolants because they were less efficient. Moreover, it appeared to be possible to diminish the ignition risk by clever refrigerator design. So, what happened? Let me summarize what we have seen. The Green Freeze was an innovation, and it was a responsible innovation because it better met values of safety, health and sustainability. It was also an radical innovation, because it was the first time in 60 years that a flammable coolant was used. And third, it was an innovation that was initiated by outsiders. In this case, it was Greenpeace and the East German company Vorwerk. Thank you for your attention.